This lesson looks at an introduction to hypothesis testing. Here's our goal. We want to make an inference about a parameter by examining the descriptive statistics. So recall that a parameter is a characteristic of a population. And for the sake of the discussion, let's assume that that population is infinitely large, so it is impossible for us to identify exactly what that parameter is. But in the process of hypothesis testing, we don't say what the parameter is. You're never going to say that we have evidence that mu equals 5, or we have evidence that sigma is 12. Rather, we want to say what the parameter is not. We might say we have evidence that the mean is not 10, or we have evidence that the standard deviation is more than 6. So hypothesis testing doesn't tell us what the parameter is, but rather it tells us what it isn't. There's some terms we need to define. We have a null hypothesis, an alternate hypothesis, test statistics, p-values, and conclusions. So we'll try to have some ideas what those mean in the context of hypothesis testing. If we're doing a null hypothesis, the null hypothesis must contain an equal sign. The symbol that we use for a null hypothesis is H0, H sub 0. So you'll notice all of these null hypotheses have equal signs. The H0 could be mu, the parameter equals 100. It could be P, the population proportion equals 0.6. It could be the variance, sigma squared, again, a parameter equals 50. But in essence, the null hypothesis is a straw man. It is set up in order to be knocked down. The usual goal of the researcher is to reject the null hypothesis. For example, if our H0 is mu equals 100, we might have enough evidence to say, no, you know what, looking at our descriptive statistics and how extreme they are, we can conclude that mu probably wasn't 100, that the parameter underlying this data set probably was not 100. Now, the alternate hypothesis can have either a less than sign, a greater than sign, or a not equal sign. If we're taking a less than or a greater than, it's a one-tail test. So if you're saying the alternative hypothesis is mu is less than 5, well then, the only way you're going to have evidence for that is if it's all in one tail, if everything is to the left. Similar sort of argument for the right, and we'll see how that works a little bit later. If we have not equals, if a number doesn't equal 10, it could either be a lot smaller than 10, or it could be a lot greater than 10. So that's what we mean by a two-tail test. So here's some examples. The notation I like to use for alternate hypothesis is H sub A. A lot of authors like to use H sub 1. So here are potential alternate hypotheses. We could say mu is not 100. We could say P is less than 0.6. We could say sigma squared is greater than 50. This first example would be a two-tailed test. This would be a one-tailed test to the left, and this would be a one-tailed test to the right. So those will be important ideas for us to keep in mind. Each problem must have a pair of hypotheses. So we have a null hypothesis together with an alternate hypothesis. And again, the null hypothesis always has to have an equal sign. And notice these hypotheses always include parameters. So you'll notice mu is a parameter. Notice the null hypothesis has an equal sign. So the null hypothesis mu equals 100 versus the alternate hypothesis mu does not equal 100, two-tailed test. Here is a potential pair of hypotheses for the variance. We could say H0 is sigma squared equals 50 versus HA, sigma squared is greater than 50. This would be a one-tail test. The only way that we're going to reject H0 is if the sigma squared, if the S squared is a whole lot bigger than 50. Notice if S squared is a whole lot bigger than 50, the chances are that the underlying variance was not 50. And here's one more. We're going to say H0P equals 0.6. The population parameter equals 0.6 versus, well, maybe not. Maybe the population parameter was less than 0.6. So the only way we're going to have evidence for HA is if P hat, the statistic, is quite a bit less than 0.6. So to do this analysis, we have to compute test statistics. These are the numbers that we're going to analyze to see just how extreme our values are. So you could have the test statistic T, which we use when we compare means. So we're going to take X bar, the statistic, minus mu, the parameter, or the perceived parameter that shows up in h naught, divided by s over root n. That will be our test statistic for t. For p's, p hat is a statistic, p is a parameter, so we could say p hat minus p divided by the square root of pq over n. This is the test statistic we knew when we're comparing proportions. And then we're going to say chi square equals n minus 1 s squared over sigma squared. So we will look at various versions of these test statistics in some later presentations. But the key idea here is this notion of p-value. So let's talk about this. Assuming the null hypothesis is true, the probability of selecting a random sample with values as extreme or more extreme as those given is the p-value. So we're going to assume h naught is true. We're going to assume mu equals some number. And then we're going to find the likelihood of getting a sample with an x bar as extreme as the one given or more extreme than the one given. If the p-value is small, then we're going to argue that the null hypothesis probably wasn't true. If our results are so extreme that the likelihood of that happening is so low, we conclude that the assumption probably was wrong, that our h naught, our null hypothesis, probably wasn't correct. So let's take a look at an example. Here's a standard problem. We're testing the population mean versus 40, and the alternate hypothesis tells us, well, we believe there's a pretty good chance that the population mean is really larger than 40. Now, the only chance I have to reject the null hypothesis and have evidence for HA is if my statistic, x bar, is a lot bigger than 40. If I get x bar as 40.1, is that evidence that the mean isn't 40? Well, you don't expect x bar and mu to be exactly the same. So 40.1, I would imagine, is fair. Maybe 41 is fair. But at some point, we've got to say the probability is so low that this is not true, likely speaking. So here are some numbers that we have. We're going to have a sample of size 35, x bar is 46, and s is 12. And we want to assume that the null hypothesis is true. We want to assume that this sample comes from a population with a mean of 40. So our question is, what is the probability that a random sample of 35 would have that mean of 46 or more? That probability, which represents the likelihood of getting results as extreme, 46 or more. Why am I just saying or more? Because it is a one-tailed test. That probability is the p-value. If the p-value is really, really small, then we conclude that the null hypothesis was probably wrong. When we reject the null hypothesis, we conclude that there is evidence supporting the alternate hypothesis. If not, if the p-value isn't small, then there's a chance H naught is true. And what we say there is fail to reject H naught. We do not have enough evidence to conclude that the mean is greater than 40. Population mean is bigger than 40. So let's look at some MINITAB simulations. We want to construct several samples assuming the null hypothesis is true. So we want mu to be 40. We want to compare our samples to the samples we have here. So I'm going to construct a sample of size 35, since we have n is 35, from a population with a mean of 40, because that's what we're assuming in H naught, and a standard deviation of 12. Yes, s is 12, but I'm kind of letting s stand in for sigma in our discussion here. And then we want to find the probability of getting results as extreme or more extreme than the given statistics. So what will that mean? That means we're going to look for how many samples have a mean that is more than 46. If you're more than 46, you're more extreme than the samples that were given. If that's very unlikely, then this is likely false. But if that's relatively likely, if the probability is fairly high, then we conclude there's a chance that H naught is true, so we cannot reject it. So you can see what we have here. We're going to take 10,000 numbers, put them in C1 through C35. They all come from normal distributions with a mean of 40. That's what we're assuming. Mu is 40. And a standard deviation is 12. Well, we're letting the S of 12 stand in for sigma. We want to take the row mean. So we're going to take row mean, C1 through C35. And we want to put that into C37. So C37 will have a column of means. Then we're going to say sort C37, C38. So we'll put all of those means that were in C37 in order in column 38. So we are looking in C38 and we want to find the probability that the X bars, that those averages, probability that the X bars are greater than 46. So looking at C38, how many of them are going to be more than 46? And you'll see not too many. How many do we have that are more than 46? Well, the first one we have here is 9983. So I believe that is a total of 18 out of 10,000. So what is that? 0.01018 is our p-value. And when the p-value is real small, is it likely to get numbers that are as extreme as the ones we had? What were the numbers that we had? We had an X bar of 46 and a standard deviation of 12 with 35 numbers. And looking at MINITAB, that probability was 0.0018. And 0.0018 is a very small p-value. And we would say, since the p-value is small, we reject the null hypothesis. So what do we conclude? So what do we have? Again, our H0 and our HA and our information here, but our p-value is small. Since the p-value is small, we're unlikely to get numbers this extreme, so we reject H0. We throw H0 out, which means we have evidence to support the alternative hypothesis. And what exactly does that mean? That means that the sample that we're studying likely comes from a population with a population mean that is more than 40. And that concludes this presentation.